Welcome to Stormont Presbyterian Church. It's so good to have you join us for this online service. We gather each week in this building. We do so not out of habit, not out of tradition, but out of a heartfelt desire to worship God. We come to acknowledge that He's our Creator. He is the one who gives us life. But more than that, He is the God who loves us. And in Jesus Christ, God has declared and demonstrated His amazing love for us. We come to worship Him. So I invite you to join me now as we pray together. Let's do that. Let's pray. Loving God, our gracious, our Heavenly Father, we bless and thank You for the opportunity to take time and to come and worship You. Father, our lives can be frantic, even though we are restricted in so many ways still, yet we pack our days with all sorts of activities. And sometimes, because of that, we let the important things get squeezed out. And there's nothing more important than spending time with You. You are our God. You have given us life, and in Jesus Christ, You offer to us new life, eternal life. You're the God who cares for us and understands us. Indeed, You know us better than we know ourselves. There's no hiding place with You. There's no pretense. We come before You and know that You can see us, and You see all our faults and failings, all our flaws, all our mistakes, all the mess that we try so hard to hide from one another. So we come to You with all of that, all our stuff, all that the Bible would call our sin. And we say, sorry, Lord. Sorry for making a mess. Sorry for hurting others. Sorry for letting You down. Sorry for failing to live the life You call us to live. And we ask forgiveness. We pray that You will pour Your Spirit upon us and wash away that sin. Give us a fresh start, a new beginning with You today. That as we listen to the words of Scripture and song, as we engage with the prayers, as we reflect on the message, that we will hear Your voice. And hearing Your voice, we will respond, not just with our minds, but with our hearts and with our souls. We offer this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you, Lord, for the gift of another day and for the gift of salvation. Thank you that in Christ you meet our deepest need for forgiveness of sins and restoring relationship with you. Help us to remember that we have been redeemed, not with perishable things such as silver and gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, and that we have been redeemed with a purpose. As your people, we are redeemed to bear witness by sharing the gospel and living it out. We pray today for persecuted Christians throughout the world who are facing opposition, marginalisation in society, and even death, because they are following you. Please strengthen them in their faith and give them courage to persevere, knowing that those who suffer for the sake of Christ will also share in his glory. We pray for young people in our schools and universities who are seeking to live as witnesses for you while facing peer pressure to blend in and follow the world standards. May they have courage to stand out and be different. We pray that all of us in Christian communities will be unafraid to be identified with a worldview that celebrates the truth about God and the gospel, even when this is not popular. We pray for your blessing on the life and witness of other churches connected with us here in Stormont. Rehope that meets in this building on Sunday afternoons, and our neighbours St. Malouis Parish Church, with whom we are linked through Messy Church. Please encourage and give fresh energy, strength and vision to their respective pastors, Josh and Emma, and to our own minister Albin, as our church families emerge from what has been such a challenging year. We are also redeemed to serve. Thank you, Lord, for those who have gone out from this congregation to serve you in many different places. Today we pray especially for Brent and ask that he will know your grace and wisdom as he supports all the naval officers who work at the Navy's airbase in Yeovilton. Thank you for the opportunities you have given him to come alongside those of all ranks and backgrounds to support them with listening and prayer. May there be an increasing openness to the gospel, and may Brent's life and witness be used to make a real impact for Christ as he leads a retreat in November and helps to shape future discussions around culture and conduct in the Royal Navy. Lord, you call each one of us to serve and use our gifts in different capacities. We pray for those here in Stormont who help as musicians, technical support, those who welcome others, serve on committees, teach and support our young people, and those who pray. May we be people who serve joyfully and sacrificially. Lord, we are also called to live justly and to seek peace in a world that is filled with conflict and pain. So we give thanks for organisations like Christian Aid and pray that the money raised during Christian Aid Week will bring help and hope to those who need it most. We pray also for world leaders, knowing that all things are under your sovereign control, and ask that you would guide their decision making for the good of all people. Please bless and use those who are actively working as peacemakers in areas where there is conflict and violence, so we may see your kingdom come and your will be done throughout the earth. And we ask all of these prayers in Jesus' name. Amen.
The reading is from John 11, verses 17 to 31. Jesus comforts the sisters of Lazarus. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now, Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha answered, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die, and whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? Yes, Lord, she replied. I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who has come into the world. After she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. The teacher is here, she said, and is asking for you. When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now, Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews, who had been with Mary in the house comforting her, noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there.
There are moments in your life, occasions, events that stand out. They stand out as being significant because they have a life-changing quality about them. It might be meeting somebody, or it might be being present when history is being made. Or maybe a conversation that just totally changes your perspective. We call such moments turning points. The author of one of the Gospels, John, gathers together a series of life-changing moments, of conversations and events that transformed lives and transformed history. Here's how John describes his whole gospel account. We read this in John chapter 20 and verses 30 and 31. John writes, Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. There are two key words that stand out here in John's purpose statement. Believe and life. That's what John wants to share with his readers. That's what John wants his readers to experience and know and be shaped by. Belief that brings life. John points to Jesus from the very first line of his gospel. John 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. Right to the very last line. Jesus did many other things as well. It is in Jesus that life is found. And it is by believing in Jesus that life is experienced. John was an eyewitness to Jesus' teaching and actions. John had a front row seat to an array of miraculous signs. He was present for Jesus' teaching and the messages of forgiveness and freedom and a hope-filled future that Jesus had come to declare and to demonstrate and indeed to deliver. As we follow John's narrative, it seems that on every page there's a turning point, a moment, an occasion of profound significance. Turning water into wine, feeding thousands from meager resources, walking on water, healing the paralyzed man by the pool, or the man blind from birth using just mud. John lines up the evidence for us. And alongside these signs, these miraculous events, John presents us with Jesus' statements about himself. Uniquely, John records not one, but seven statements of self-disclosure by Jesus. Collectively, we refer to them as the I am sayings. They each have their own setting and their own context, but together they provide the most comprehensive picture of Jesus, his character, his compassion, but most significantly, his purpose and his mission. Only on one such occasion does Jesus present a direct challenge following such a statement of self-disclosure. And we find it here in John chapter 11. Jesus says, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? Do you believe this?" That's the question that Jesus posed to Martha. Together with her sister Mary and her recently deceased brother Lazarus, Martha is described as by John as part of a family that Jesus knew and loved and cared for. He stayed with them. He shared life with them. He was very close to them. And yet, when word reaches Jesus that his beloved friend Lazarus is seriously ill, Jesus doesn't drop everything and run. He doesn't make his way immediately to the bedside of his ailing friend. Indeed, we're told that he remained where he was for 2 further days before setting out for Bethany, the home of Mary and Martha and Lazarus. As John describes Jesus' arrival into the outskirts of the village, it's very clear that Lazarus is already dead. Indeed, later in the story, we're told that he's been in the tomb, in the grave, for 4 days. Understandably, Martha and Mary are distraught. And with Jesus' arrival, there's a sense of what might have been, if only, if only. Now we know what if only means, don't we? We can look back at events and moments and think to ourselves, if only. For us, if only represents broken dreams and shattered hopes. If only for us represents missed opportunities, regrets that will haunt us. If only. And yet, as Jesus chats with Martha, he doesn't join her in the speculation about if only. Instead, he invites her to look at the but now. Jesus may avoid or ignore the if only, but he doesn't avoid and he doesn't ignore the real issue that's at hand here, the issue of life and death. Look at what Jesus says here. "The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die." Jesus is the giver of life. Here in this encounter, he gives life back to Lazarus. We read that in verses 43 and following. Jesus called out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and his feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. And yet what Jesus speaks of with Martha is so much more than simply giving life back. Jesus says, "Will live even though they die, and believing in me will never die." Jesus points beyond the if only that so often dominates our thinking, especially when we come face to face with our own mortality. Jesus offers us a new perspective of but now. With Jesus, death is no longer the last great enemy. Jesus declares, "I am the resurrection and the life." And notice the order: resurrection followed by life. Jesus points here to the greatest turning point in the gospel narrative, the greatest turning point in history. His death would be transformed by his resurrection. His giving of his own life would result in new life for all who will believe in him and trust in him. And so to Martha, Jesus asked, "Do you believe this?" Her reply, "Yes, Lord, I believe," and what followed turned her whole world upside down and would from that point on revolutionize her view of life. This was a life-shaping and life-giving event. This morning, you and I have the privilege to read and to hear the words of Jesus. And yet we're also presented with the same challenge. Do you believe this? And why does that matter? Well, for this reason, believing brings life. Believing brings us into life, and believing guarantees us life, even though our physical bodies will at some point pass away. What difference will it make then, here and now? If I believe Jesus is the resurrection and the life, how will that affect the way that I live, the way that I interact with the people around me? How will that impact my choices and my decisions day by day? Let me offer you three reasons why believing Jesus is the resurrection and the life will make a difference to you and your life. And we see these three reasons here in the narrative that John presents us with in chapter 11. The first reason is about authority. Martha's response to Jesus' question, "Do you believe this?" is to say, "Yes, Lord, I believe. I believe you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who is to come into the world." Martha recognizes who Jesus is and the authority he has as the Son of God, as the Messiah. Acknowledging and accepting Jesus' authority over life and death moves Martha away from the if only to the but now. No longer bound by the past, Martha is open to a new future, a hope-filled future. You and I live in a world, in a society, more inclined to question or undermine authority than to acknowledge and accept it. We, as a society, have made the autonomy of the individual into an idol. Self-determination is now the driving force. We accept no authority but our own. I decide. I choose, I determine. Martha had her own ideas about what could, even should have happened when they sent news to Jesus about her brother's illness. Now, in light of Jesus' words, Martha understands what Isaiah recorded. "For my thoughts are not your thoughts. Neither are my ways, your ways, my ways," declares the Lord. Believing in Jesus is about authority. It's about acknowledging and accepting Jesus' authority as the Savior and as Lord. With this comes freedom, not enslavement, because Jesus' authority is displayed in life-giving, not life-denying words and actions. It's about authority. The second reason, it's about love. Martha's sister Mary was a very different person, very different temperament. So as John describes what's happening, we find that Mary is at home and she is being consoled by her friends until Jesus calls for her. Face to face with Jesus, Mary discovers Jesus' compassion and his love. Listen to how John describes the scene. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. John 11:33-35. Here's Jesus' love playing for all to see. His tears are, yes, tears of sympathy, but more than that, they are tears about the lie that death perpetuates. There can be more. There is more to life than death. Jesus has come into this world, in his own words, that they may have life and have it to the full. John 10:10. Believing in Jesus is about love. His love for us and for our salvation. Jesus didn't come into this world to simply make it a little bit better, or to give us a little bit more, or to eliminate some of the stuff that makes it hard and difficult. Jesus came into the world to demonstrate God's love for us in this, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. God's love is not about acceptance, and it's not about affirmation. God's love is not about acceptance, and it's not about affirmation. God's love is about transformation. It's about new life. Life free from the power and the penalty of sin. Life filled with the Spirit of God, shaped by faith and hope. Life through the resurrection. It's about authority, it's about love, it's about power. As John describes the climax of this incredible story, we can sometimes overlook the impact of Jesus' words and actions on the crowd that were witnessing this. As they watched Lazarus walking unaided from the tomb, where 4 days earlier they'd witnessed his dead, lifeless body being carried into the tomb and laid out. John writes, "The dead man came out, his hand and his feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, 'Take off the grave clothes and let him go.' Therefore, many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary and had seen what Jesus did, believed in him." John 11:44-45. Believing in Jesus is about power. It's about God's power, the power over life and death, the power that transforms and changes and heals and restores and makes new and gives life. Jesus' question, "Do you believe this?" is an invitation to trust. But it's more than that. It's an invitation to acknowledge and accept Jesus' authority. It's an invitation to experience and revel in his love. It's an invitation to receive and live out of his power. The life that you and I live is a life filled with choices. We have choices about authority and about love and about power. There is no greater or more significant choice that you and I face than the one captured in the simplicity of the question Jesus posed to Martha. Do you believe this? If we dare to say, "Yes, Lord, I believe," then we acknowledge his authority. We're transformed by his love, and we're empowered by his Spirit to live life in all its fullness. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though he dies. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, help us today to sit with these words of invitation, these words of instruction, these words that call us to acknowledge and accept your authority, these words that call us to experience and know your love, these words that call us to receive your power into our lives. Help us in these moments not simply to nod in our acceptance of these words, but help us to bow and to come before you with heart, mind, and soul. And help us to utter that same response that Martha did. Yes, Lord, I believe. Hear this, our prayer. We ask it in your precious name. Amen. Join me now as we say together the words of the prayer that Jesus has taught us to pray, say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now may the amazing grace of the Master Jesus Christ and the extravagant love of God the Father and the intimate friendship of God the Holy Spirit be with you all now and always. Amen.